Good afternoon. I got asked if I would introduce our next speaker, and I thought, well, you know, being a good academician, I should go do some research. So I went over to the shelf and I unplugged my Gutenberg device, Webster's Dictionary. Bear with me while I get my glasses on. But I thought I should look up the word photojournalist, because at the root of this introduction about photojournalism, I should be able to define photojournalist. So I turned to page 885. You can follow along if you have your Gutenberg device with you. And I looked up the word photojournalist. And I found some really interesting things. It's a term that was introduced in 1938. But what I began reading that I found really amazing is the pronunciation and the root of the word photojournalist is, and I'm reading directly here, is Michel duCille. You think I'm kidding. You look him up, photojournalist, in the dictionary, and it has our next speaker, photographed. A three-time Pulitzer Prize winner. First in 1987 in Spot News Photography, again in 1988 for Feature Photography, in 2008 for Public Service. Michel duCille came to us as a teenager from Jamaica. He has worked at a number of newspapers. He has led the Washington Post into being one of the powerhouse visual newspapers in this country. He is someone that has made a huge mark on this industry, and as someone that has worked in the industry, he was a role model for the rest of us. It is a tremendous honor to introduce to you one of the most amazing, one of the people that has made the most impact on photojournalism in my lifetime, as it says in the book, the person that has defined what photojournalists are and what they do, Mr. Michel duCille.
I had no idea. Wow, I've got to go with that. I'm really happy to be here with you all today, and thank you all for inviting me back. Chuck Scott, I was hoping Chuck would be here to at least pay him a visit, because Chuck was trying something that he never quite got off the ground. He was trying to say that, look, professionals who are editors or photographers, they can't really take 2 years off to come and get their master's degree at Ohio University. So why don't we set up a program to help them get their degree without having to move here? Well, Chuck and I tried it and tried it and tried it, and finally the school said, no. You have to be on campus for at least some of the time. So I am happy to be back on campus. Being introduced as a three-time Pulitzer Prize winner is something that I still can't wrap my brain around. Most people who know me know that I'm all about being humble and about being a regular person. It is slightly embarrassing, honestly, to be introduced as a three-time Pulitzer Prize winner. The only wish that I had was that, you know, a few million dollars would come with that whenever I get introduced, you know. But that hasn't happened, trust me. So I do want to talk today about the future. And as you, I'm going to start off showing you my early work, my work from the Pulitzers. But I guess, you know, the Gutenberg says photojournalists, I'm the traditional guy. I mean, multimedia was not, you know, at the front of my brain in the years when I began. I started in high school. I started being a photographer in high school. and I've done nothing else. I did a little stint as a janitor and failed at that. So I can do nothing else. But as you look at the work, and I hope you can see at, if you don't see the future in the work, trust me, it's up here, it's moving, because the future really is not just being a picture taker. I think Keith said it well this morning when he said it's not enough. It's not enough to just be a picture taker. And the reasons are many. We can talk later during the other sessions about what the reasons are why media is moving and changing. But storytelling is really the bottom line for me. You know, there were storytellers in the caveman days. They drew pictures on the walls. You know, I'm one of those. So, okay. Many of you are just coming back from lunch, and some of the pictures are tough to look at. Blood, guts, you name it. So, you've been warned. In 1985, November of 1985, the a volcano in Colombia, the Nevado del Ruiz volcano, erupted, and instead of spewing ash and the usual fire and brimstone, it really melted the ice cap to this volcano and flooded an entire town that killed 25,000 people. So the Miami Herald sent myself and Carol Guzy down to Colombia, South America, to cover the volcanic eruption. And I think it's known to many as the mudslide of 1985. Could we go down with the lights just a smidge? I'm showing you both work from me and Carol. Working beside Carol Guzy, who is a four-time Pulitzer Prize winner. I think the only other person that we know is O'Neill, who was one for literature. But try working elbow to elbow with Carol Guzy four times. So many of these pictures are Carol's. She and I shot the same picture. I shot it in black and white. She shot it in color. They used hers. So the rescue was just an amazing situation there. The entire village, town, was covered by mud and water. This is a classic case. Is my portable mic working? Can I move around? This is a classic case of... these were the days when we shot color film, and there were color slides that had to be shipped back to Miami to be processed. Well, I got mixed up about whether I had color or black and white in the camera and shot this in black and white. And of course I heard about it in the office later. But I actually prefer this in black and white. I think in color it would have been, probably you wouldn't have seen the rescue as well. So it's now 1987, And I, crack cocaine is a huge deal in Miami in the mid-80s. The epidemic was just beyond your imagination. So we were doing a lot of stories about crack. And I felt like the face of crack was being projected by my newspaper and the media as a black face. And I felt that it was really wrong to project that only black folks were doing crack. So I proposed to go and do a story to show the entire community consumed by crack, and worked quite a bit to show. But I also found this one housing project in Miami that really was taken over by the drug dealers. Whites, Hispanics, blacks came to this place to buy and use crack cocaine. I spent about 7 months working on the story, not 100% full time. At the time, I was in the beginning stages of them bugging me to be a photo editor. And so I would work as a photo editor for a couple of days and then go do my story. It turned out that this photograph of this woman using crack, you know, it had all the mood and the, it fit the magazine cover, it just worked. And boy, it burned me up, because here I was trying to say that crack's not a black problem, and the picture they chose to be on the cover is a black face. I, to this day, haven't sorted that out. But there were people of other races coming to this place. The apartment, it's the projects, right? So some of the projects are boarded up and empty. So the crack users and dealers use the empty apartments to just do their thing. The police came in there quite often, doing their bus. So that was 1988, old school, shot on film, and for those of you who don't know what film is, it's those little things with sprockets in them, and this is when T-Max just came out, which is 3200, and that saved me, actually. Boy, I wish I had that Nikon that we have now, with ISO 64,000. So fast forward to 2008, I moved from the Miami Herald to the Washington Post as picture editor in 1988. Literally weeks after winning the Pulitzer Prize, I was already leaving when the Pulitzer Prize was announced, so I didn't leave because of it. But I left to be an editor, and I wanted to have that sense of being able to manage a staff, being able to craft the images in the newspaper, being able to share the storytelling with photographers, to really be the photographer's advocate. So I became a photo editor. And then in 17 and a half years later, in 2005, I decided, well, it's time to go back to shooting before I get old, and I was ready to go back to shooting. So I went back to shooting and did a couple of projects, did a series with a bunch of photographers on being a black man, which was very fun to work on. And then Keith was actually my editor. Yes, that same Keith Jenkins right there. Keith came to me and said, you know, Dana Priest and Hull, they're working on this story, and I think you ought to go talk to them about, you know, working on this project. At the time, I had no idea what this project really was going to be. I knew that they were investigating how soldiers were being treated after they came back from the war at Walter Reed and at other medical institutions. But I didn't know the depth of what it would be. This is Building 18, the famous Building 18, which is a old no-tell motel across the street from Walter Reed that they took over and housed soldiers because they had an overflow of soldiers. They didn't have enough rooms at the hospital, so they would house those who weren't as sick in Building 18. But it was dilapidated. Oops, I think I'm out of sequence. I wanted to show you my famous mold on the wall picture. Here we go. So Dana one day just said, you know, I'm going to go talk to this guy. His name is Jeremy. And he's in Building 18. Let's just go have dinner with him. So we had dinner. And after dinner, he said, you know, you want to come with me and let me show you the mold on the wall. Well, you know, mold? How do you photograph mold? So I went, I snuck my camera in a little gem bag and went in and I took the picture. And I didn't think much of it, actually. I was like, okay, I'll take the picture. He had been injured and literally lost his ear and his hearing, and he was in the process of having surgery. I want to say one thing. You know, a lot of people think that the Walter Reed series and that we were talking about the medicine at Walter Reed. It really was not about the medicine. Walter Reed, the story that Washington Post did in 2007 that won the Public Service Pulitzer was about the treatment of soldiers after they came back. The treatment that the government did not have the correct response for the heroes who came back from war. So I always want to make sure that people know that when we say Walter Reed, we're not talking about how bad a hospital it was. It was not a bad hospital. It's the government that was bad. So anyway, he took me in and showed me his mold. I'm going to go back. So we continued the story and really did a lot of work with other soldiers who desperately needed help. This was one soldier who was a sniper, had been shot in the face. he's a sniper. He was shot by a sniper. This soldier actually attempted suicide, and in the process of attempting suicide, she shot someone else, and the whole process was maddening because she was suffering from severe PTSD, but yet the military brought her up on charges to court-martial her. It went through a very long process, but she was given, she was set free and got the treatment that she needed for PTSD. The other soldier that suffered severely from PTSD was Josh Calloway, the guy on the left. He watched his sergeant get blown up by an IED in Iraq. And it affected him. So he was at Walter Reed, there for treatment, but his treatment consisted of going to Reveille in the morning, getting medication, going to a counseling session, and that was it. They did not have any direct treatment for PTSD. This is 2007. He would sit in his room, he'd play video games. What's that? The famous war video game? His grandfather came to visit and just was stunned by how his grandson was affected by the war. The McLeods, he was a National Guardsman who had traumatic brain injury, and the same thing. The treatment and getting the services that they need and getting the financial support that they need just wasn't there. Another soldier who was pretty incapacitated, but yet the military was very slow. He'd get medical care, but there were all these other things that he needed, you know, a place to live where the, you know, wheelchair accessible, all of the financial things that soldiers needed to come home and get solved was lax by the government. Most of these soldiers, PTSD was the biggest issue with them. And this was a program in Cincinnati that tried to at least deal with some of their issues. So of course, the story runs, all hell breaks loose, everybody's up in arms, and they have a hearing. Congressional hearing. Boy, have you ever heard of that? I have. So they had a congressional hearing at Walter Reed, and Jeremy and the McLeod and Duncan came to testify. And this was the general who was also brought in front of the hearing room to speak about the treatment of soldiers. So, so that's the Pulitzer. So can we stop talking about it now? I want to talk a little bit about, you know, media and where we're going. I don't have all the answers. I feel like, for me, the photojournalist, the old school guy, I'm in the infant stages of it. I've done a little audio. I worked with Keith on doing some audio for the Walter Reed Project. I don't know if we'll have time to show some of that. I haven't done a whole lot of video, but I've always felt that there's this kind of craziness going on because we get so panicky and anxiety-ridden about what I perceive to be a change that perhaps normal is not the right word, but things have always changed for newspapers. And I speak about newspapers because that's what I do. But media has always changed. This is the front page of the Washington Post. I believe it's 1877. Do you see any pictures? See any pictures now? That was 1972. And that's last year when we decided to do the winter solstice in HDR. Now, I'm not answering any questions about HDR. So those of you who start thinking about HDR questions, I'm not going to answer them. All I can tell you is that we said in the caption that it was HDR. And for those of you who don't know, HDR means high dynamic range. I want to show you an old clip. And I hope I didn't lose the... I had it up before, and I think I'm going to now have to find it again. Bear with me.
Turning on your home computer to read the day's newspaper. Well, it's not as far-fetched as it may seem. In fact, both local San Francisco papers are investing a lot of money to try and get a service just like that started. Science editor Steve Newman reports on one person already using the brand new system.
17 stories up in his fashionable North Beach apartment, Richard Heller is calling a local number that will connect him with a computer in Columbus, Ohio.
Should I just reload?
If you will, sitting down to your morning coffee, turning on your home computer to read the day's newspaper. Well, it's not as far-fetched as it may seem. In fact, both local San Francisco papers are investing a lot of money to try and get a service just like that started. Science editor Steve Newman reports on one person already using the brand new system.
17 stories up in his fashionable North Beach apartment, Richard Heller is calling a local number that will connect him with a computer in Columbus, Ohio. Meanwhile, across town in this less than fashionable cubbyhole of the San Francisco Examiner, these editors are programming today's copy of the paper into that same Ohio computer. When the telephone connection between these two terminals is made, the newest form of electronic journalism lights up Mr. Howland's television with just about everything the Examiner prints in its regular edition. That is, with the exception of pictures, ads, and the comics. 8 newspapers around the country are currently in the computer network, and within the next few weeks, 3 others will join in.
This is an experiment. We're trying to figure out what it's going to mean to us as editors and reporters and what it means to the home user. And we're not in it to make money. We're probably not going to lose a lot, but we aren't going to make much either.
Both Examiner and Chronicle began service within the last 2 weeks and printed full-page ads about it. Of the estimated 2,000 to 3,000 home computer owners in the Bay Area, the Chronicle reports over 500 have responded by sending back coupons. Even though the electronic newspaper isn't as spiffy-looking as the ads imply, people using the system are excited about its potential.
With this system, we have the option not only of seeing the newspaper on the screen, but also, we can copy it. So anything we're interested in, we could go back in again and copy it onto paper and save it, which I think is the future of the type of interrogation an individual will give to the newspapers.
This is only the first step in newspapers by computer. Engineers now predict the day will come when we get all our newspapers and magazines by home computer, but that's a few years off. So for the moment at least, this fellow isn't worried about being out of a job. Steve Miller, News Center 4.
Well, it takes over 2 hours to receive the entire text of the newspaper over the phone, and with an hourly news charge of $5, the new telepaper won't be much competition for the 20-cent street edition.
Does that sound familiar? I mean, okay, I'm going to show my age here because this was 1981, and I was just leaving college, and who knew? So I show this because I feel like the discussions that have been going on recently about newspapers dying and about the internet taking over, and I feel like we're going through some kind of a future shock. There was a book written by Alvin Toffler titled Future Shock. And he defined it as a personal perception of too much change in too short a time. That's how I feel. It's like a lot of change in such a short period of time. Because we, as photojournalists, we are, picture takers. And now we are expected to be more than picture takers. I believe that. I'd rather believe that all these changes that's going on, the shock that's going on with us, I'd rather believe that it's simply adapting. And I don't want to seem like I'm in denial, because many of my friends have lost jobs because of the changes that are going on. My own newsroom has experienced immense change. We now have, we don't have a copy desk, we have a multi-platform desk. We have this big circular entity in the newsroom that half of the circle is the web and the other half is print. And so these changes have affected me, they've affected all of us. But my message to you who are students and are educators is to think of it as an adaptation, a change. Since we've been going through this for some time now, since the mid-90s, talking about these changes, the area that most concerns me is that idea of storytelling. Has all these changes, all the electronic doodahs and all of the, you gotta go do video, you gotta do audio, you gotta do all of these things. Have all of that confused us into thinking that the most important thing is not the story? That the most important thing is not to try to communicate the story in some kind of really impactful way? I wanted to read you a piece that a friend of mine wrote. Just one second. See all these doodads that I have here. Old friend of mine, Mary Jo Moss, she was a photo editor in around the country for some time. And she and I actually, she was in a master's program at Indiana and I was an undergrad. But she was always very passionate about photojournalism. Her words are, and I really want to read it out loud so that it can kind of set there for you. Photographs, and I put in brackets, photo, pictures, video, audio, nothing media, must be storytelling and evocative of the human experience. Express synthetically through light and composition. For pictures to have journalistic integrity, they must be sensitive executions of the camera, as possible. The best pictures are those of real people doing real things, where situations are allowed to naturally evolve, where photographers have the opportunity to connect with the subjects and to share their experience, where photographs can go beyond literal the picture. And I think when you look at that piece that Keith showed this morning from World Press, was that from the Los Angeles Times, the guy that was on painkillers? It expressed all of this, but it had audio. It had video. It had great pictures. So I'm hoping to impress on you that the storytelling can be powerful without just doing video for video's sake, audio for audio's sake, pictures for pictures' sake. Because if you're not a master of at least one, I think at least one of those things you ought to be really, really good at. Or else you're just putting a bunch of things together. I'd like to kind of segue into where the future is now, where it's going. And again, I do not have all the answers, but I have a pretty good idea that these changes that are moving so fast, they're going to settle down and level off into something that was pretty much like, you know, the Washington Post without any pictures on it. Because in their day, that's what was normal. That was cutting edge, you know. 18 stories on the front page, you know. No pictures. But I think the future is going to level off. And I think the change, the adaptation, is going to continue, but I think it's going to level off. I may not be there to see it. I don't want to get all the MLK on you, but I may not be there, but I think it's going to level off. I'm going to cheat a little bit and talk about the New York Times. Don't anybody tell anybody that the Washington Post is talking about the New York Times. But I hope you all have seen Snowfall. If you haven't, can you read the URL? Write it down. I actually, first time I saw it, I went, what are they doing? They they must have spent a lot of money on snow, on an avalanche. And then I decided to give it a second look. And it offers a template, in my opinion, that perhaps could be a direction for where the future newspaper will be. Now, if you agree, I do. First of all, I don't think that the print paper is going to go away. I read somewhere that the last newspaper will be in 2043. Well, I may not be there for that. But I don't think that the print newspaper is ever going to completely go away. I believe that it's going to be all of the above. It's going to be a web whatever. We may be reading the paper through our glasses. We already are reading the paper through our telephones. So wherever it is, it's going to level off. But this could be a template. So what I think the Snowfall Project offers is just another window into how presentation will be for the future newspaper, the future magazine, the future. So here's a story, and
I had
videos right there. I didn't have to go to another window.
I was being tossed over and over and over. It was like being in a washing machine. I didn't know which way was up. I didn't know which way was down. I couldn't see anything.
I'm still learning how to maneuver this thing.
I couldn't.
So I gotta go back.
There's
stop that.
So much snow, and there was a.
And then I was like, oh, man, I'm dizzy. They're making me dizzy. What is this? You know, then I realize what this is offering. It's graphics. It's photos. It's video. It's audio. And they're all in the same place, which is what your morning newspaper is. You're reading the paper and you're turning pages. It's all right there. What drives me crazy with the Washington Post is when I read it online, it's like, oh God, I gotta go click here. I've lost my place. And I don't have it all in one place. And it goes on forever. I heard, and where's Megan? Megan can tell you later, I think. They spent a lot of money designing this thing. And a lot of time. So, enough about the New York Times. But check it out if you haven't seen it. And maybe Megan can tell you more later in our later session. This is the Washington Post version of what we came out with this. I believe it hit the day after Election Day. It's called, and you can still find it, washingtonpost.com/supergrid/run. And again, it is trying to present a story all in the same place. All on the same plane. I don't know what the new fangled word is for it. Do you, Keith?
Multiple.
All right, Internet, don't fail me now. So, let me start from the beginning. So, it starts here, starts in June. So, all these photographs were from our staff, wire photos, and it's video, it's stories. It's, I think there may be some audio, but as you click on a photo, there you are with the caption. Oh, Herman K. came. I always think of him as Stan. Let's see if I can find one that has video. See, we're trying to figure it out, right? Here's a story. You scroll, read the story. It's all in the same place. Is it as elegant as snowfall? I don't know, you tell me. But the idea is that we're trying to figure out where the future is. Where are we going with the newspaper? We're not going to fold a tent and go home. I did find a video one earlier. Maybe it was Mr. Gingrich. It's kind of makes you dizzy. Because, you know, there's a video.
This is an honor to address you, and one I had not expected, and one I value very highly. I appreciate the chance to speak first, even before Vice President Biden will get his turn tomorrow. I just hope the Obama campaign doesn't think you're playing favor.
So you get the idea. But I can't help but feel that this presentation doesn't quite do justice to the photographs. Because, you know, I'm a photo guy. I'm all about telling you the story with the photographs. So I'm still trying to sort out how I feel about all these pictures, and it's just so overwhelming almost. You know, it comes at you. And perhaps for some of you young people that are used to YouTube and all the, you know, fancy social media stuff, maybe that doesn't matter to you that your eye's all over the place. So that's Super Grid Run, and I know that we are either developing and working with this more, trying to come up with other ways of presenting stories, of presenting the newspaper. The photo department, we try to bring our own ideas to the table. Indeed, I should have told you earlier that going to South America for the mudslide was my idea. I've always been an insomniac, and I was watching TV and saw just a little blurb that said that there had been this big tragedy in South America, and I decided I'm going, and I was all packed and ready, and then called my boss and said, "Hey, I want to go." And thank goodness he let me go, but he sent Carol Guzy. He sent Carol Guzy as backup, and I'm glad he did. So we come up with our own idea. So the photographers came up with an idea. Bonnie Jo Mount and Lena Merrill came up with the idea of trying to do an audio presentation. They did the audio tracks up here, which I'll play for you in a second. But Bonnie Jo also went out and tried to do an essay on, you know, the milieu of the election. The here's where we are with this big election about to happen. So we got the design folks to help us put together this, you know, the essays here. And here are the audio.
Women's issues, both low-income women and middle-income women. He was raised by two very strong women, seeing a lot of poverty, international poverty in Indonesia, In his presidency, he has shown heart in issues that benefit women. His health care reform efforts has so many benefits to women of all income levels, but particularly the poor women.
So you can't stop that one. And I discovered the other night as I was playing with this, if you don't stop that one and go to the next one, both of them start playing. So, you know, again, we're trying to figure out ways to present the news. And this is a totally photo-driven idea. There's no story, there's a little essay, and we had a partner who was a writer help us write the copy. But it's all here. Here is what normal people, specifically in this particular one, women,
Obama
have to say.
Stands for the black African Americans. He stands for
about Obama and the election. And I should say, the question was, regardless of who you support, which candidate do you trust to do a better job addressing women's issues, Obama or Romney? Why? We called it Liberty Through the Lens. And I think we did three of these. But still, you know, even with this presentation, I think the bottom line, great storytelling of great photographs is still alive and well. You know, our photo galleries at the Washington Post are tops. They get, in a given month, they get millions of hits. These photographs are from the earthquake in Haiti. Carol Guzy, that name comes up a lot because Carol is just a phenomenal photojournalist. And actually, Stan, I think Carol is the one that's defined as a photojournalist. But Carol Guzy, Nikki Khan, full disclosure, Nikki Khan is my spouse, and she hates it when I tell people. She said, "Why do you have to tell people?" Well, I'm proud of her. So Nikki Khan, Carol Guzy, first they were the two that went down to Haiti together. And then we subsequently sent Nikki back, and then subsequently sent Ricky Cariotti back. So here, and these are the photographs that won the 2010 Pulitzer Prize for breaking news in 2010. So I'm still struggling with the traditional pictures. Sometimes I just want to take pictures. I don't want to do audio. I don't want to do video. I don't want to do anything else but really work on great pictures. What's wrong with that? You know? So I think what we have to do is all of the above. Because I'll just keep quiet and show you these pictures. Because the power of these pictures just are amazing. So this is like months later. This is August. Earthquake happened in January, it's August. And in the background is the presidential palace, still damaged. And, you know, that was the fountain that was in front. People are still living on the street. And as if it wasn't enough in the fall, a cholera epidemic hit Haiti with a vengeance. Mickey went back and captured this image of a guy who never made it to the hospital. And cholera is something that is treatable. But it was so immense that people died in droves. So the power of great photographs is also something that I want to leave you with, that message that if your passion is being a great photojournalist, yes, Keith says that you have to, in this modern age, do all of the above, because that's what your employers, your prospective employers, are going to require. But I say, yes, I agree with that. I myself, I'm back to shooting now. You know, lots of aches and pains, but I'm back to shooting. Flew in from an assignment last night. And I've got to wrap my mind around the future. I've got to wrap my mind around doing audio, doing more audio than I have in the past. Doing a little video, I'm trying to teach myself a video. I hate Final Cut Pro. Or whatever the hell it is now, X or whatever. I just got through thinking that I mastered Photoshop, but I'm not Final Cut, Jesus. You know, but I gotta wrap my mind around it. But don't lose the strength of the great photograph. I want to just show you a couple of galleries of the campaign that we covered. We, you know, the Washington Post, politics is our Super Bowl. You know, the election year is big for us. So we sent photographers out and drove all over the country to cover the campaign, and spent a lot of money. So I'll try to name some of the photographers as we go. This is Lucian Perkins, who's one of our retirees that we won't just want to let him go. So Melina Mara followed Romney throughout the entire campaign. And then Nikki Khan followed, what's that name again? Followed Obama throughout the entire campaign, and we sent a few people to relieve them throughout the latter part of the year, but pretty much we stayed with the candidates full time and begged and tried our best to get behind the scenes and get images that, you know, is not the everyday stand behind a microphone kind of a picture. This is the day that he was accused of, you know, infidelity. I think Melina got a lot of access for Romney, mainly because when you're not the president, access is so much better. You know, when you're the president, it's tough to get anything natural, anything behind the scenes. You literally have to spend days upon days upon days asking, can I get a picture of him standing in a hallway somewhere? This is from the convention. We covered the convention massively. I went down to be editor on site at the convention. We did a little thing in print and on the web on convention bling, you know, fashion at the convention. Bonnie Jo Mao decided to do hipstamatic, you know, and we actually ran these in the paper. All of the above. iPhone pictures. I don't really care what the tool is. You know, whatever the tool is to communicate a message. I was in the auditorium, I was running cards, you know, because here I was in a high-paid courier to it was amazing what we did. The current way that when you're covering a big event like this, to cover it properly, because they want the pictures back, just like that. It's just like TV, you know? When can I get it? They want it now. They want it to be just like satellite TV. Press the button and it's rolling. So I was running cars. One of the photographers was in a place where we couldn't hook up their cameras because our new camera, you can hook up an Ethernet port to the camera and send the images directly back to the office and they're editing the pictures back in the office. So I had to, this particular photographer was not hooked up, so I had to run their cards and then I would go and send the pictures. But I was doing it from the floor. And I looked up and I go, who's he talking to? Because I couldn't see the chair. And then I looked up at the big screen up above and I went, what? Anyway, Melina did get some great access. We set up a remote camera and wired it. The campaign trail is brutal. I honestly don't think I ever want to do it because you're working 20-hour days sometimes, at least 14-hour days, lying everywhere with the candidates, and everything is scripted, and everything is, you know, they're controlled. So as a photojournalist trying to make pictures in these modern days of politicians who control everything, it's really quite a task. And I think our folks really delivered on this last election. One more quick so the other gallery was pretty much convention and a campaign trail, so this is mostly Nikki's stuff, but other photographers too, of Obama during the during his campaign, which essentially started after the State of the Union address, the 2012, January 2012 address. This photo is by Molina Mero, and that's Gabby Gifford. So we essentially started sending Nikki out like right after June, July, to be with President Obama. This is actually in D.C. at the Vietnam Memorial by Bill O'Leary. So the power of the photograph. Single image, story is still with us. I think one of the things that have the multimedia environment has given us is the ability to present more. You know, in the newspaper, as with shrinking pages, we could present, you know, even if it's a page, that's only four or five pictures. With a photo gallery, gosh, you know, we could give you 15, 20 images, and it can be a complete essay, and you can really capture the whole story with or without the video audio components. And I think that's a great thing. Because as a photojournalist, you know, I want people to see my images. I want them to be impacted by my images. But be good at least one of them. I don't think it's enough to just do each one for its own sake. I know that may go against what some of your teachers are saying, because they're right. You do need to be, you need to be able to do all of those things, all of the tools. You have to be strong at using those tools. But for me, I think it starts with being a strong photojournalist. Actually, I think that's my photo. You're on the, when you're on the road, you know, there's no stopping to take. And you can't stop the motorcade to take that picture. I think it's amazing that she was able to get that picture. I love the one that says, Obama biggest hoax in American history. No Obama 2012. Michael Williamson, he sent him to Ohio to talk to voters and capture what their thoughts were. think he was able to spend a little bit of time behind the scenes with them. I mean, they gave her like 10 minutes before he went to give a speech. And this is in Iowa. He flew back to Iowa the last night. So I guess this would have been Monday night, Tuesday morning, election day, right? I think this picture was actually taken past midnight. It was his last stop. And he said, I'm coming back to Iowa, for this last moment. And he teared up. And election night. We actually ran that picture in this is the first edition, because we didn't have the images yet, the celebration images. Some people say you should not have run the tear picture because it doesn't say Obama wins, but when you know the story behind it, you know, he was just so emotional about the last stop and, you know, would I win? I think the tears really, really spoke. So I just want to leave you with a thought. A couple of thoughts. I'd like to challenge you as students and faculty to sort out whatever dilemma we're going through, whatever the anxiety is. You're gonna have to sort it out. It's all on you guys. I'm too old. I've been there. And as you sort it out, great storytelling is the bottom. We must be the filter. We must be the storyteller. We must be the voice for the public. We're the trained ones. We have to process fact from fiction, truth from competed agendas. We have to go back to the basics. Regardless of what your tools are, you must be a complete journalist. Truth, accuracy, fairness. Checking the facts. As visitor journalists, we can't take a second-class role. You know, when I started out, you always heard the jokes about photographers who can't spell and can't write. But we can't take that on us anymore. We can't take that role anymore. Oh, I'm just a photographer. We've got to be a complete journalist. We've got to be a complete storyteller. I want to leave you with a quote, a little story from. We've had hundreds of people retire and leave in the last 5 years from the Washington Post. But one of them stuck with me. And I asked him afterwards to share what he had written down. He was retiring. His name is David Hoffman. He was a foreign editor at the Washington Post for a gazillion years. Before that, he had covered the White House. He had done many things at the Washington Post. And he was leaving. And he says this. It was September, a few months after Watergate break-in, Bob Woodward and Bernstein unearthed the facts of the secret fund controlled by Attorney General John Mitchell. They were in Ben Bradley's office giving him a rundown about a long, definitive piece they were going to write. and they then began to do. He interrupted them with a wave of his hand and said, "Listen, fellows, are you certain on Mitchell?" "Absolutely certain." He stared at the reporters. They said yes. "Can you write it now?" Ben stood up and waved his hand and said, "Well then, let's do it." They did, and you all know what happened. This moment happened right here in this room. He's talking about the Washington Post. In our time, and it has happened 100 times since then, we did the gutsy, hard work of finding the truth. Lately, I hear a lot of doubts about journalism, with uncertainty and fear. My friends, doubts are the last thing that we need. Doubts are the last thing that we need. We are in the middle of an information revolution. People are inundated, just swamped with information. They need to make sense of it. They need to see through the clouds. We are the beacon. The only thing that can extinguish our light is forgetting who we are, forgetting our legacy, forgetting Ben's wonderful determination, and Emily's remarkable courage. He's talking about one of the foreign reporters. This is what we are about. We discover, we reveal, we explore, and we must have no fear. Please, as I leave you, I beg you, don't be deterred from this great mission. Don't let the doubts distract you from our highest calling. You are the ones who will save the Washington Post. And I'm going to say to you that you're the ones that will save journalism. Thank you.